I'm sure you've heard someone say or joke about having a panic attack, but panic attacks are very real situations where someone has a sudden period of intense fear or discomfort that something bad's going to happen, and that there's some imminent threat or danger. These feelings are often so intense that they're accompanied by physiological symptoms like heart palpitations, dizziness, or shortness of breath. These symptoms peak within the first 10 to 20 minutes, but some might last hours. Sometimes patients having a panic attack might feel as though they're having a heart attack or some other life-threatening illness. Panic attacks can happen even in familiar places where there are no real threats and therefore they're unpredictable, which can further increase anxiety about when the next panic attack is going to happen. In order to be characterized as a panic attack, though, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual for Mental Disorders, the 5th edition, or the DSM-5, says patients need to have an abrupt onset of 4 of the following 13 symptoms. Pounding heart or fast heart rate, chest pain or discomfort, sweating, trembling, shortness of breath, nausea, dizziness, chills, numbness, feelings of choking, feelings of being detached from oneself, fears of losing control, and fears of dying. Admittedly, some of these symptoms might naturally happen together, and so they can be very hard to tease apart. For example, it'd be unusual for a person that's sweating, feeling dizzy, and feeling chills to also not be trembling. It's also important to note that some of these are physical symptoms, whereas others are specific thoughts or ideas. Panic attacks can happen in the context of several mental disorders, including depressive disorders, post-traumatic stress disorder, and substance abuse disorders. It can also, however, happen in the context of a panic disorder, which is basically defined by the panic attacks being recurrent, meaning two or more, and unexpected. In addition, the DSM-5 says that for somebody to be diagnosed with a panic disorder, they also need to have persistent worry or change in behavior because of their panic attacks. Also, the panic attacks can't be due to the effects of some substance, like an illicit drug or medication. Finally, the panic attacks aren't better explained by some other anxiety disorder, like agoraphobia or social anxiety disorder. Patients with a panic disorder can't predict where the panic attack will happen next, so it's important to get treated before patients develop something called avoidance, which is when they actively avoid the places where one previously happened. They might stop doing activities that they think might trigger the attacks, like going to the park, riding in elevators, or driving. Avoiding these situations might temporarily reduce symptoms of anxiety about having a panic attack, but it makes daily life really tough, right? And ultimately doesn't stop the attacks from happening. Sometimes patients get anxiety just thinking about the possibility of having a panic attack, and this is called anticipatory anxiety. And this can be particularly debilitating because it might cause the patient to be reclusive and choose to endure the attacks alone instead of risking an attack in public. This situation can actually lead to the development of agoraphobia, a fear of going into crowded spaces. Panic disorder is twice as common among women as men, and it appears to have a genetic component and run in families, although we don't exactly know what causes it. Treating someone with panic disorder usually involves psychotherapy, medication, or both. Cognitive behavior therapy has been an effective type of psychotherapy for patients with panic disorder, and this relies on 5 fundamental steps. First, they just learn about the panic disorder and how to identify certain symptoms. Second, they monitor their panic attacks using a diary. Third, they work on breathing and relaxation techniques. Fourth, they start rethinking and changing their beliefs about the severity of a panic attack from totally catastrophic to a realistic level. And fifth, they allow themselves to be exposed to situations that provoke fear and anxiety. Now, if medications are used, antidepressants like SSRIs are the most commonly prescribed, which have sedative and relaxing effects. Anti-anxiety medications might also be prescribed, like benzodiazepines, which also have a relaxing effect, although the use of anti-anxiety medications can sometimes lead to unwanted side effects like tolerance, dependence, and withdrawal. If very severe, anti-seizure medication may sometimes be prescribed. Overall, though, between cognitive behavior therapy and medication, many patients can be effectively treated for panic disorder.